I promise you I have other mugs besides this one. This is just always the one I end up using when I'm filming for some reason. I have a lot of other mugs, trust me. Love that tea. Hi everyone, my name is Rebecca and welcome back to... Okay, I gotta take this thing off, it doesn't feel right. Today's episode will be focusing in on the second episode of series 2, The Hound of Baskerville. I didn't quite get to it in the video on Escandal in Belgravia, but I want to take some time now to talk about the theme of the second series overall. You might already know from production staff interviews that one of the writer's main goals in the second series was to have Sherlock facing love, fear, and death in each episode respectively. The writers have also said that one of their goals with the second series was to get three of the most well-known stories out of the way. So they tackled Irene Adler, The Hound, and Moriarty. If you've seen The Reichenbach Fall, you know that Moriarty doesn't actually kill Sherlock. And if you've seen my episode on A Scandal in Belgravia, you know that the love Sherlock had to come to terms with in that episode was John's love for him, not Irene's. So it's safe to assume, based on the subversive nature of the themes of the other episodes, the Hound is actually a red herring when it comes to the source of Sherlock's fear. There's something deeper causing Sherlock to feel afraid, and it's the same reason he felt afraid in A Scandal in Belgravia. He knows his feelings for John put John in danger, and so Moriarty has to be stopped. That's the fear Sherlock is facing in this episode. But back to them tackling three of the biggest stories. At the time, the writer said that their reason for this was not wanting to defer the pleasure of seeing those stories told in their world. There might be some truth in that, but as much as these guys love red herrings, it should be clear that there's something else going on here. If you listen to the commentary for The Hound of Baskerville, it's clear that Mark Gatiss felt considerable pressure when adapting what is by far the most well-known home story.
Do you feel a huge pressure because it's one of the ones that's been done?
Yeah. Christ, yes.
The pressure was smoking out of him at times.
Mark talks a lot about how he felt pressure to adapt the story in a certain way that would meet audiences' expectations. He specifically mentions that if he were adapting a story like, say, The Sign of the Four, he wouldn't have felt nearly as much pressure to tell the story a certain way because the story isn't as well known.
It's worth saying that because it's so well known, if it was a version of The Sign of Four, you just wouldn't feel the pressure to, not just pressure of its fame, but the pressure to include certain things. People have seen so many versions.
Yes.
I think they know certain beats of the story. Mm-hmm. It feels wrong not to do.
Since we as an audience now know what the writers did when given the liberty to adapt The Sign of Four the way they wanted, I think it's pretty obvious why they wanted to get these well-known stories out of the way. It's because at this point, the writers knew they would be allowed to tell the story that they wanted to tell, a slow-developing love story between John and Sherlock. But they knew that the audience would be expecting certain moments from a Holmes adaptation, things like Sherlock facing Irene and the Hound and Moriarty. And the only way to include these stories without compromising their own vision was to get them out of the way before the romance had progressed enough that an adaptation of any of these stories would be unrecognizable. The progression of this series is John coming to accept that he will never be with Sherlock romantically and choosing him anyway, and Sherlock realizing that John loves him and pushing him away to keep him safe. At this point in their relationship, the well-known stories can still work as a way to keep Sherlock and John apart. Again, The Hound of the Baskervilles is perhaps the most well-known Holmes story. Mark Gatiss clearly knew that going in, and so it's very telling how he chose to adapt the story knowing that. He took this most well-known story that was originally about ghosts, or a dog painted to look like a ghost, and instead made it all about government conspiracies, people hiding the truth, and a few brave souls seeking it out. They talk about this constantly in the commentary.
And Nixon said, "They showed me the alien."
No.
Yeah. What about it?
I hope it's true.
Notice there, she does a brilliant thing. She rubs her nose, indicating she's lying.
Infection. Of course I'm doing it right now.
I mean, almost anything could go on underground or wherever.
Wow.
Or is that them just trying to big up their part?
It's clever, isn't it? That's the best way of doing it, really. It's a bit like the idea that UFO people have, is that actually it's in the government's interest to keep the conspiracy theories going because it blurs, it actually makes the real thing less tangible. You know, as long as it's like, of course it's madness.
Yeah.
Because that clouds the real issue. Yeah. They encourage people to look like geeks.
We're all victims of the bloody system.
Actually, that reminds me of something.
I know, it's just a mystery. We'll an internet phenomenon.
Oh, what did Mark remember? They're all my favourites. The conspiracy theory.
and it's absolutely central to the plot of the episode. In adapting the most well-known Holmes story, Mark Gatiss is basically directly telling the audience to be thinking about conspiracy and to be looking for hidden truths. That premise alone is looking great for TJLC. But let's finally get into the plot. The episode opens with Henry Knight as a child running away from whatever killed his father. Now I'm going to be switching it up here a little bit. If you're familiar with Sherlock theories, you'll know a lot of people see Henry Knight as a Sherlock mirror. I'll be approaching this episode reading him as a John mirror instead.
What were your thoughts about how he dressed? I remember you had some...
Who, Henry?
Yeah, particular thoughts about him. Because we didn't get out to talk about John Watson, but there's a similarity there both.
I think that's what it was originally. I was going to be... We are quite similar in clothes, though.
I will be explaining why, and also why that's important. For now, the image of Henry running as a frightened boy ends up being a flashback. At this point in the story, only one other character has been given an on-screen flashback to establish their troubled past. Now to our main characters. We see right off the bat that Sherlock is obviously keyed up.
Nothing.
Military coup in Uganda? Another photo of you with the...
Going back to a scandal in Belgravia, if he knows that he's in love with John and that John loves him back, but believes he can't act on it because it would put them both in immediate danger, but John is so available and right there, it would make sense that he's starting to lose control. Despite what he says, he's not an unfeeling machine. He's a volcano, and he's about 2 seconds from erupting.
Nothing of importance? Oh, God!
He tries to distract himself by frantically playing with a giant harpoon, and if you saw the episode on sexual imagery, you remember what that represents. We can see he's upset about romance specifically in the way that he tears down Mrs. Hudson's new relationship.
How about a nice cuppa, and perhaps you can put away your harpoon?
I need something stronger than tea. Perhaps 7% stronger.
Hoping to see Mr. Chatterjee again.
Please.
I wouldn't put any hopes on that cruiser, Mr. Chatterjee. He's got a wife in Doncaster that nobody knows about.
Sure.
Well, nobody except me.
It's the same as Sherlock getting annoyed at Molly's Christmas present for her new boyfriend. The fact that other people get to be in relationships greatly annoys him, especially because their relationships are all terrible, and he knows that he and John would be wonderful together if everything would just let them. John, as usual, has no idea what's causing all of this.
The bloody hell was all that about?
Don't understand.
He tries to tell Sherlock to apologize to Mrs. Hudson, and we get this exchange.
Go after her and apologize.
Apologize?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, John, I envy you so much.
You envy me?
Your mind, so placid, straightforward, barely used. Mine's like an engine racing out of control. A rocket tearing itself to pieces, trapped on the launch pad. I need a case!
You've just solved one by harpooning a dead pig, apparently.
That was this morning. When's the next one?
Which I happened to recognize when I was researching for a scandal in Belgravia.
How I envy you your mind, Watson.
You do?
It's placid, imperturbable, prosaic. But my mind rebels against stagnation. It's like a racing engine tearing itself to pieces because it's not connected up with the work for which it was built.
Now in that scene, Holmes is trying to distract himself with cases so he won't take drugs. Later, when he does take drugs, Watson asks if he's ashamed of himself, to which he replies that he is, but that the drugs will take care of it.
Aren't you ashamed of yourself?
Thoroughly. But this will take care of it.
In that film, the root cause of Holmes' problem wasn't the drugs, but the feelings that he was taking the drugs to repress. Specifically, his desires for Watson. It's the same here. Sherlock wants cases to distract from wanting drugs, and he wants the drugs to distract from his desires. He's a mess. John, again, has no idea all of this is going on, and asks if there are any cases on Sherlock's website. Sherlock pulls up a message from a young girl whose rabbit started glowing in the dark and then mysteriously vanished.
Dear Mr. Sherlock Holmes, I can't find Bluebell anywhere. Please, 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 can you help?
Bluebell?
A rabbit, John!
Oh.
Ah, but there's more. Before Bluebell disappeared, it turned luminous. Like a fairy, according to little Kirsty.
Like a fairy? Was that really necessary?
Then the next morning, Bluebell was gone. Hutch still locked. No sign of a forced entry. What am I saying? This is brilliant. Phone Lestrade. Tell him there's an escaped rabbit.
At first it seems like a throwaway, but Bluebell comes back throughout the episode, so it's important to keep the details of this case in mind. And we get another hint in this scene at what's been looming in Sherlock's mind for a while now. Sherlock mentions playing Cluedo.
It's this. Or Cluedo.
No. We are never playing that again.
Why not?
Because it's not actually possible for the victim to have done it, Sherlock. That's why.
Was there any possible solution?
It's not in the rules.
Well, then the rules are wrong.
From the scene alone, it just sounds like Sherlock doesn't understand how the game works. But an entry posted on John's blog after Sherlock's staged suicide tells us that Sherlock kept insisting that the victim likewise faked his own death, and the Cluedo board was stabbed above the mantelpiece in a scandal in Belgravia.
How can we do anything while she has the photographs? Our hands are tied.
So he's been trying to plant this seed in John's mind for quite a while. He suspects that one outcome might be him having to fake his death, though it's understandably something he'd like to avoid because that would mean leaving John. Anyway, the Reichenbach foreshadowing is interrupted by a client arriving, and we get one of the many domestic moments that make this episode a favorite for a lot of people.
Single ring.
Maximum pressure just under the half second. Client.
This is where we get properly introduced to this episode's obsession with conspiracies. They could have introduced the Hound in any number of ways, but they specifically did it on a conspiracy TV special.
There are many who believe that within this compound, in the heart of this ancient wilderness, there are horrors beyond imagining. But the real question is, are all of them still inside?
Sherlock shuts off the program and asks for Henry's account instead.
What did you see?
Oh, I was just about to say.
Yes, in a TV interview. I prefer to do my own editing.
Yes. Sorry, yes, of course.
But it's clear he's not taking him very seriously at first.
There's a place. It's a sort of local landmark called Dewar's Hollow. That's an ancient name for the devil.
So?
One important thing to note at the start here is that the Hound is associated with the devil, just like Moriarty is.
Did you see the devil that night?
Yes.
Henry makes the point that at least the people on TV took his theory seriously.
My dad was always going on about the things they were doing at Baskerville. About the type of monsters they were breeding there. People used to laugh at him. At least the TV people took me seriously.
Sherlock dismisses that, but this is the geek interpreter case all over again. Sherlock time and again is brought cases that involve the truth being concealed or covered up or manipulated, and again he helps the victim find the truth. Henry almost leaves because Sherlock isn't taking him seriously enough, but comes back when Sherlock says he already knew why he was there.
Not sure you can help me, Mr. Holmes, since you find it all so funny.
Because of what happened last night.
Why, what happened last night? How do you know?
I didn't know, I noticed.
This is where Henry as a John mirror starts to come into play, because now Sherlock has decided to distract himself by showing off for Henry and John.
Not Jack. Now, Sherlock.
Oh, please, I've been cooped up in here for ages.
You're just showing off.
Of course, I am a show-off, that's what we do.
He points out things like Henry not being interested in the woman that liked him.
Been over the last four digits yourself and another pen, so you wanted to keep the number. Just now they used the napkin to blow your nose. Maybe you're not that into her after all.
Being desperate for a cigarette.
Then there's the nicotine stains on your fingers, your shaking fingers. I know the signs. No chance to smoke one on the train. No time to roll one before you got a cab here. It's just after 9:15. You're desperate.
And having a therapist, just like John.
That's what Dr. Mortimer says.
Who? His therapist.
My therapist.
Obviously.
While John tries to get details from Henry, Sherlock is trying to vicariously find satisfaction in Henry's cigarette.
Henry, your parents both died, and you were, what, 7 years old?
I know.
Okay, bud, chill. Henry then explains exactly what he saw that made him rush to London, and anyone who tries to argue that details don't matter on this show should keep this in mind.
Mr. Holmes, they were the footprints of a gigantic hound.
Say that again.
Mr. Holmes, they were the footprints of a gigantic hound.
I'll take the case.
We later learn that Sherlock only takes the case because of his word choice, because even small details can hold vital information. They play with the fact that for most of the story, Holmes isn't actually present, but then step around it.
You'll come down then?
No, I can't leave London at the moment, far too busy. But don't worry.
Putting my best man onto it.
Don't need those anymore, I'm going to Dartmoor.
Before John and Sherlock leave Baker Street, they see Mrs. Hudson getting into a fight with her new boyfriend when she finds out about his secret lives.
Oh, looks like Mrs. Hudson finally got to the wife in Doncaster.
Until she finds out about the one in Islamabad.
Sherlock and John stop on the way to scout out Baskerville.
There's Baskerville.
That's Grimpen Village. So that must be... Yes, Dewar's Hollow.
My friend Marcel recently pointed out that while at first it seems like Baskerville is the source of the Hound, again associated with the devil and Moriarty, that monster is really out in the moor. What's really being hid in the base are rabbits that glow like fairies. Marcel made the point that what they're really hiding in Baskerville is the gay truth about the home stories, which will become more and more clear throughout the episode. But the path to the truth is a literal minefield.
What's that? Minefield? Technically, Baskerville's an army base, so I guess they've always been keen to keep people out.
Clearly.
When John and Sherlock arrive in the town, Sherlock makes a fuss about putting up his coat collar, and John discreetly looks over at him.
Your lives!
Come.
This comes back in a few minutes. Before they go inside the Cross Keys Inn, yes, really, that's the name, we cut back to Henry in therapy, getting closer to finding the truth.
Oh, there's something else.
Liberty.
In. Liberty in. What do you think it means?
And again, there's only one other character we've been shown in therapy.
Yeah, good. Very good.
One of the main shots they use is focused on a large mirror. Back in the inn, we get some incidentally gay characters, one of whom assumes right off the bat that John and Sherlock are in a relationship.
Sorry we couldn't do a double room for you boys.
That's fine. We're not...
These guys will be coming back a lot next week, but Burly Gay, as I like to call him, is wearing a red button-up and is saying ta a lot, as is John, even though he doesn't usually say it that much.
There you go.
Oh, ta. I'll just get your change.
Ta.
Then the innkeeper's partner comes over and also assumes that John and Sherlock are in a relationship.
What with the monster and the ruddy prisoner? I don't know how we sleep nice. Do you, Gary?
Like a baby.
That's not true. He's a snorer.
Hey, pshht.
Is yours a snorer?
Got any crisps?
I wonder why all gay people assume John and Sherlock are in love. It's notable that John has stopped correcting people about this. He half-heartedly tried at the beginning of the conversation, but quickly gave up, even before knowing the innkeeper was gay. He's accepted that his devotion is obvious, and so keeps his mouth shut, the same way Sherlock never corrects anyone who assumes he's gay. Outside, Sherlock notices that Fletcher has a horse racing magazine. So knows that a bet will be one way to approach him. Again, showing that small details like newspaper headings matter a lot on this show. John comes out and instantly adapts to Sherlock's plan.
That's off, John, sorry.
What? Bet?
My plan needs darkness. Reckon we got another half an hour.
Wait, what bet?
Oh, I bet John here 50 quid that you couldn't prove you'd seen the Hound.
Yeah, the guys in the pub said you could.
Again, The Hound of the Baskervilles was originally a ghost story, but it was adapted to put an emphasis on conspiracies and people in power hiding the truth.
Ooh, is it haunted? Is that supposed to convince me?
Ah, don't be stupid. Nothing like that. But I reckon there is something out there. Something from Baskerville. Escaped.
A clone? A super dog?
Maybe. God knows what they've been spraying on us all these years. Or putting in the water. I wouldn't trust them as far as I could spit.
Is that the best you've got?
He said he'd seen terrible things. Rats as big as dogs, he said. And dogs. Dogs the size of horses.
It's at this point that they decide to investigate the military base Baskerville itself. Keeping in mind the symbolism of what's waiting inside Baskerville, it's nice that Mycroft, played by the writer Mark Gatiss, is the first key to getting in the base.
Mycroft's name literally opens doors.
Next on the path to the gay rabbits is getting past the guards. The place is teeming with soldiers. And Sherlock doesn't quite know how to handle the situation, but fortunately for him, John does.
Is there something wrong, sir?
Well, I hope not, Corporal, I hope not.
It's just we don't get inspected here, you see, sir. It just doesn't happen.
Ever heard of a spot check?
Captain John Watson, 5th Northumberland Fusiliers.
Sir, Major Barrymore won't be pleased, sir. He'll want to see you both.
I'm afraid we won't have time for that. We'll need the full tour right away. Carry on. That's an order, Corporal.
Yes, sir.
John pulling rank got them one step closer to the heart of the base. And not even going into the symbolism, it's obvious that Sherlock enjoyed that.
Nice touch.
Haven't pulled rank in ages.
Enjoy it?
Oh, yeah.
When they get deep into the lab, they come across Dr. Stapleton, who just happens to relate back to the Bluebell case.
Dr. Stapleton?
Stapleton. Stapleton. I knew your name.
Doubt it.
People say there's no such thing as coincidence.
Dull lives they must lead.
Like the audience, John is surprised at this turn of events.
Did we just break into a military base to investigate a rabbit?
As Marcel said, it's a bait and switch. You're expecting the government to be hiding a monster, but the real cover-up is a bunch of luminous rabbits that glow like fairies. Mycroft finally catches on to what they're doing and starts texting them. These texts here make the mysterious M at the end of the blind baker being Mycroft much more likely. He's the only one who goes by M.
23 minutes, Mycroft's getting slow. Deeply, hugely.
The whole point of-
And we haven't seen Moriarty do the same. Before John and Sherlock can safely make it out of the base, they're intercepted by Major Barrymore, who we'll later learn is hugely conservative. He's cast in a very antagonistic light.
Major, this is bloody outrageous.
Why wasn't I told? The whole point of Baskerville was to eliminate this kind of bureaucratic
nonsense. I'm so sorry, Major.
Inspections! You,
sir! ID unauthorized, sir.
What?
I've just had the call.
Is that right? Who are you?
They're saved by Dr. Franklin.
It's all right, Major. I know exactly who these gentlemen are.
You do?
Yeah, I'm getting a little slow on faces, but Mr. Holmes here isn't someone I expected to show up in this place. Good to see you again, Mycroft.
He seems helpful here, but we know from the rest of the episode that he's just using the opportunity to throw Sherlock off the scent. Considering that Henry is a John Muir and is at the stage where he's trying to defend the reputation of a dead loved one who everyone else thinks is a fake, Dr. Franklin being a falsely supportive father figure who's really desperately trying to keep John from the truth has a lot in common with Mary. He's still being helpful for now, though.
Thank you.
This is about Henry Knife, isn't it? I thought so. I knew he wanted help, but I didn't realize we were going to contact Sherlock Holmes.
He mentions both reading Sherlock's blog, which is something almost no one but villains do.
But don't worry, I know you really are. I'm never off your website.
And enjoying John's blog, especially the Aluminium Crutch.
I love the blog too, Dr. Watson.
Oh, she is.
The pink thing. And mm-hmm. That one about the Aluminium Crutch.
Yes.
Like I said in the Belgravia video, this entry is a transcription of a series of voice messages that Sherlock left John. Sherlock went to a play to distract himself while John was on a date and ended up witnessing a murder. Sherlock explains the whole thing to John, even when he's not there, while simultaneously claiming that he's too busy to talk to the police. And the show draws attention to this train wreck twice. Towards the end of this conversation, we get another example of a small word choice making a huge difference.
Here's my cell number.
And here Franklin is trying to plant suspicion on Stapleton, who already seems suspicious because she did kill her daughter's rabbit.
Tell me about Dr. Stapleton.
Never speak ill of a colleague.
Did you speak well of one which you're clearly omitting to do?
I do seem to be, don't I?
John tries to get more information about the rabbit, but Sherlock refuses to answer, and we get this delightful exchange.
So? So?
What was all that about the rabbit? Oh, please, can we not do this time?
Do what?
You being all mysterious with your cheekbones and turning your coat collar up so you look cool.
I don't do that.
Yeah, you do.
Where to start? I guess by pointing out the obvious callback to Irene in the last episode.
Look at those cheekbones. I could cut myself slapping that face.
And then can we talk about the ridiculousness of someone reading this scene as John being platonically frustrated with the attractiveness of his friend's cheekbones?
You being all mysterious with your cheekbones.
And then go on to the way that John's eyes drift down in this conversation. And really just, the poor man is suffering. Free him. It's understandable then that John won't let the gay rabbits go. He asks about it again in the car.
So the email from Kirsty, the missing luminous rabbit.
Kirsty Stapleton, whose mother specializes in genetic manipulation.
She made her daughter's rabbit glow in the dark.
So we know that Dr. Stapleton performs secret genetic experiments on animals. The question is, has she been working on something deadlier than a rabbit?
We know the only thing that Dr. Stapleton is working on is rabbits, which again symbolize the hidden gay truth, and they make the point that there isn't actually anything harmful about that.
To be fair, that is quite a wide field.
John and Sherlock then go to visit Henry. You can see again that Sherlock is preoccupied with death.
Mean anything to you?
Liberty and death, isn't that the expression? Mm-hmm. The only true freedom.
But Sherlock convinces Henry to face his fears on the moor.
What now then?
Sherlock's got a plan?
Yes. Right.
We take you back out onto the moor.
Okay.
See if anything attacks you.
What?
That should bring things to a head.
At night.
On the moor, John quickly gets separated from Sherlock and Henry when he starts following the wrong signals. And ends up missing Sherlock in a vulnerable moment. Henry and Sherlock start talking about Dr. Franklin and Henry's father.
Met a friend of yours?
What?
Dr. Franklin.
Oh, right. Bob, yeah.
And we get hints that Franklin has been keeping a close eye on Henry.
Seems pretty concerned about you.
He's a worrying person. He's been very kind to me since I came back.
Sherlock is also very touchy about people talking about his relationship with John, and the implication that they might be incompatible.
But he works at Baskerville. Didn't your dad have a problem with that?
Well, mates are mates, aren't they? I mean, look at you and John.
What about us?
Well, I mean, he's a pretty straightforward bloke, and you...
Sherlock and Henry then see the Hound.
Did you see it?
Although Sherlock pretends not to have seen it at first.
What are you talking about?
I didn't see anything.
If Henry is a John mirror, that makes sense, since Sherlock generally tries to conceal his fears from John. Henry, meanwhile, is slowly losing it.
Why would he say that? It was there. It was.
Henry?
And I see this as a glimpse into what John would have become had Sherlock never come back after the Reichenbach fall. Fixated on the possibility that he was still out there, never quite fully moving on because someone close to him would be constantly manipulating him.
This is good news, John. It's good. I'm not crazy. There is a Hound. There is. And Sherlock, he saw it too.
Back at the hotel, John and Sherlock sit next to the fire, which is decorated with a heart wreath. As usual, John is very slow to notice that Sherlock is upset.
UMQRA, does that mean anything? So, okay, what have we got? We know there's footprints, because Henry found them, so did the tour guide. But we all heard something. Maybe we should just look for whoever's got a big dog.
Going back to Belgravia, where John said he would have thought Sherlock was acting heartbroken, but he acts that way all the time, it's reasonable to assume that Sherlock has been slipping up more and more and has been showing his fear. So John thinks that this behavior is just something that Sherlock does. He'll imply as much in a minute. For now, Sherlock does admit that there's something wrong, and John's first response is to tell Sherlock to be rational, because if Sherlock loses his cool, John will feel completely lost.
Henry's right.
Well,
I saw it, too.
What?
I saw it too, John.
Just a minute. You saw what?
A hound. Out there in the hollow. A gigantic hound.
Look, Sherlock, we have to be rational about this.
Okay.
Now you, of all people, can't just...
It shows how much John is depending on Sherlock to be a steady presence in his life, even if it's not what Sherlock needs to hear. Now, on the surface, it seems like Sherlock is afraid because of the Hound, but we get lots of hints that that's not really what's troubling him, like his word choice here.
Look at me, I'm afraid, John. Afraid.
Sherlock.
Always be able to keep myself distant. Divorce myself from feelings. But look, you see, body's betraying me. Interesting, yes. Emotions, grit on the lens, the fly in the ointment.
Yeah. Going forward, the writers have now explicitly told us what kinds of emotions Sherlock associates with that phrase. Romance.
If you are referring to romantic entanglement, Watson, which I rather fear you are, as I have often explained before, all emotion is abhorrent to me. It is the grit in a sensitive instrument, the crack in the lens.
Yes.
And sex.
Moriarty may beg to differ.
He's trying to distract me. Derail me. You're trying to stop me. To distract me, derail me.
Yes. He's the crack in the lens, the fly in the ointment.
It's on the tip.
So he's not really mostly afraid of the dog. The drug has exacerbated his worst fears, and he's currently terrified about his feelings for John and what will happen if he slips up and John finds out. He has to push all of this away, right now.
All right, Spock, just take it easy.
Like I said, John indicates that this has been building up for a while.
You've been pretty wired lately. You know you have.
That tells Sherlock that John is this close to finding out his feelings, and so he doubles down on the heartless sociopath angle, since he knows that will push John away.
I think you've just gone out there and got yourself a bit worked up.
Worked up?
It was dark and scary.
Me
There's nothing wrong with me.
Sherlock.
There is nothing wrong with me, do you understand?
He uses his deductions like a weapon.
Looking for a dog, yes, great dog, that's your brilliant theory. Shashalashia, good, excellent, yes, where should we start?
How about them? The sentimental widow and her son, the unemployed fisherman. The answer's yes.
Yes?
She's got a West Highland Terrier called Whiskey, not exactly what we're looking for.
Sherlock.
John makes one last attempt to reach out.
Oh, why would you listen to me? I'm just your friend.
And Sherlock uses the opportunity to push John further away.
I don't have friends.
Nah. Wonder why.
In his fear-addled mind, they're both safer this way. John heads outside and sees the flashing lights again. He decides to take a page from Sherlock's book and push all of his feelings aside by focusing on the case, which is particularly funny considering how this plays out. The signals don't have anything to do with the case. Instead...
Mr. Salden, you've done it again!
Oh, I keep catching it with my belt.
Oh, God.
The mysterious signals were actually a bunch of people having sex. I wonder what that could mean. John turns around to head back, and Sherlock starts texting him, trying to further distract John by throwing him at an attractive woman who happens to look vaguely like him, a brunette with prominent cheekbones. It's telling that Sherlock has picked up on John's type and the fact that it resembles himself. He knows John's relationships have all failed because John would rather be with him, so this is a pretty safe move in the long term, and keeps John distracted from his feelings in the short term. We cut back to Henry, who now reveals that he has a gun, another connection between him and John. There's also this very cool shot with the hound inside Henry's head, which again illustrates that framing and composition do matter on this show. John's date with Louise Mortimer doesn't go well, even before Dr. Franklin shows up, mostly because John is making it all too clear that he's there to get information on Henry.
More wine, Doctor?
You're trying to get me drunk, Doctor.
Thought never occurred.
Because a while ago, I thought you were chatting me up.
Oh, where did I go wrong?
When you started asking me about my patients.
There's another line here emphasizing the importance of conspiracies.
Wasn't he some sort of conspiracy... nutter theorist?
You're only a nutter if you're wrong.
The most genuine moment that John and Louise have is when John starts talking about how worried he is for Sherlock.
Because I have another friend who might be having the same problem.
That's when Dr. Franklin shows up. And like everyone else, after reading John's blog, he assumes that he and Sherlock are in a relationship.
Oh, Dr. Watson!
Hi.
Hello. How's the investigation going?
Hello.
What investigation?
Didn't you know? Don't you read the blog? Sherlock Holmes. It's...
Sherlock who?
Private detective. This is his PA.
PA?
Well, live-in PA.
Perfect.
John once again doesn't try to correct Dr. Franklin. He just looks resigned. Louise Mortimer quickly leaves when she realizes what's happening.
Live-in.
And implies that John might get on better with a man, which again, he doesn't deny.
Oh. Why didn't you buy him a drink? I think he likes you.
We transition to the same morning, with Sherlock standing on the same rocks that he and John were exploring yesterday. Those were a ways out from the village, so this probably implies that Sherlock avoided the inn last night. That makes sense considering that the true source of his fear is John finding out about his feelings and being put in danger by Moriarty. He'd want to avoid sleeping in the same room as him if possible. Sherlock goes to Henry Knight's house and makes a show of acting more socially awkward than he actually is in order to distract from what he's up to.
Morley! Oh, how are you feeling?
I didn't sleep very well.
Oh, that's a shame. Shall I make you some coffee?
Oh, look, you've got Dad.
This will happen again with John in a few minutes. Again, we are shown that even small word choices matter on this show.
I mean, I only saw the hound for a minute, but...
Hound.
What?
Why do you call it a hound? Why a hound?
Why? What do you mean?
It's odd, isn't it? Strange choice of words, archaic. That's why I took the case, Mr. Holmes. They'd be the footprints of a gigantic hound. Why say
Hound.
And we're getting closer to why that's important in this episode in particular. Sherlock has a theory that the reason that he saw the Hound was that he was drugged, and that the drug is in Henry's sugar, since he and John had eaten and drunk all the same things apart from that up to that point, and he decides to test it on John. In order to test it, he needs to win John back over. Since making John like him is what Sherlock actually wants to do, this part comes rather naturally.
Do you, get anywhere with that Morse code?
No.
UMQRA, wasn't it?
Umqra.
Nothing.
Umqra.
Look, forget it.
How about Louise Mortimer? Did you get anywhere with her?
No.
Too bad. Did you get any information?
You're being funny now.
Well, it might break the ice a bit.
Funny doesn't suit you. Let's stick to ice.
John.
It's fine.
Wait, what happened last night? Something happened to me, something I've not really experienced before.
Yes, you said fear. Sherlock Holmes got scared, you said.
No, it was more than that, John.
He's even sure not to wear a scarf so John can see his neck, which is effective. Look at how often John looks down.
Always been able to trust my senses, the evidence of my own eyes until last night.
You can't actually believe that you saw some kind of monster.
No, I can't believe that. I did see it, so the question is, how? How?
Yes. Yeah, right, good. So you got something to go on then? Good luck with that.
It's still not enough to make John forgive him, though. So Sherlock gives John a glimpse of how much John matters to him, but frames it as friendship because giving away anything else would be totally ruining the point.
Listen, what I said before, John, I meant it. I don't have friends. I've just got one.
Right.
Even that doesn't work, but just talking to John helps Sherlock. It always does, and he makes a break in the case.
John?
John! You are amazing! You are fantastic!
Yes, all right. Don't have to overdo it.
You'd never be the most luminous of people, but as a conductor of light, you are unbeatable.
Cheers. What?
Now that is why word choice is important in this episode specifically. The writers almost never use the word luminous, but they use it twice in this episode. Once in relation to Bluebell, and once in relation to John.
Before Bluebell disappeared, it turned luminous.
You'd never be the most luminous of people, but as a conductor of light, you are unbeatable.
They do this to tie them together, because the same thing that happened to Bluebell is about to happen to John. Kirsty almost found out the truth about her mother's work, and so Bluebell had to be taken away. John is too close to finding out what Bluebell represents, the truth about Sherlock's feelings, and so likewise has to be thrown off the scent. I'm not sure that this is something that Sherlock is deliberately doing, although there is some evidence of that considering his mental state in this episode, and a few things later on. But we will also see at other points in the series that Sherlock doesn't think drugging people is a big deal if it doesn't have any long-term effects. This probably has something to do with his own drug use. He also knows John likes danger, so that might factor in too. Either way, the experiment happens because John would soon realize Sherlock's feelings otherwise. Anyway, they see Lestrade at the inn, and Sherlock reveals that he doesn't know his first name.
Is that why you're calling yourself Greg?
That's his name.
Is it?
Yes, if you'd ever bother to find out.
This becomes a running joke, but it will also contrast something that we find out in the third series, so I'll come back to it then. Sherlock finds the opportunity to drug John, and again pretends to be more unaware than he is, this time about John's preferences.
What's this?
Coffee, I make coffee.
You never make coffee.
I just did, don't you want
you
it?
You don't have to keep apologizing.
Thanks.
I don't teach you.
John still doesn't really understand Sherlock, so it works. They confront the innkeepers, and there are a lot of exciting mirror things that I'll be getting into next week, but for now I just want to appreciate this shot.
It's dead. Pretty dead.
They're literally sharing mirrors with their respective mirrors. That's incredible! We know from the end of the episode that the dog is still alive, and from series 3 that Sherlock's childhood dog was very important to him, so he's probably lying on purpose here to protect the couple.
So, you believe them about having the dog destroyed?
No reason not to.
Like Dr. Stapleton adding the glowing gene to the rabbits, the lie Sherlock adds here is that the hound was glowing.
So that was their dog that people saw out on the moor?
Looks like it.
But that wasn't what you saw, that wasn't just an ordinary dog.
No. It was immense. It had burning red eyes and it was glowing, John. Its whole body was glowing.
They need to go back into Baskerville to test the theory safely. And so Sherlock rings Mycroft, who again is played by Mark Gatiss, so they can have access to the base and find the truth.
Hello, brother dear. How are you?
And this sequence highlights that Bluebell really is at the heart of what's being hidden in Baskerville. Before they go in, Sherlock mentions to John that it could be dangerous inside.
In the labs, Stapleton's first. Could be dangerous.
Harkening back to their first case together. Sherlock has known all along that John enjoys danger. This line makes it look like Sherlock thinking what he's about to do is okay is more likely. Remember that one of the many points of this series overall is Sherlock making the transition from being a great man to a good one. We're still pretty early in that journey. Sherlock meets Major Barrymore and is blatantly aligned with conspiracy theorists.
I don't know what the hell you expect to find here anyway.
Perhaps the truth.
About what? Oh, I see. The big coat should have told me. You're one of the conspiracy lot, aren't you?
One of the main messages of this episode is that searching for hidden truths is honorable. They're talking to us. We cut back to Henry, who is trying to sleep but is kept up by nightmares. Again, another tie back to John.
Oh, God. Oh. Oh.
Then we get to the experiment scene. John walks into the virus lab, which exposes him to the Project Hound drug. This is the same door that Dr. Franklin came out of earlier wearing a gas mask. So there have already been hints at what's really happening. One of the main horror tricks in this episode is to contrast light with darkness. John gets led away from Sherlock in the woods by flashing lights. When Henry is hallucinating in his home, he's frightened by the security lights going on and off randomly. And here, when John goes back out to the big lab, he's overwhelmed by too much light and sound, and then all the lights go off. Remember that Bluebell, the luminous rabbit, is a big part of this episode, so the light is tied to her and what she represents. John saw too much of Sherlock's feelings, and so he's pushing him away again, leaving John unable to adjust to the darkness.
Hello?
All of this happens to John in a locked room, which was always suggestive.
Disappeared from inside a locked hutch, which was always suggestive.
John literally locks himself in a cage to stay safe, like Bluebell. When Sherlock comes to get John, the lights switch on as soon as Sherlock moves the curtain and John sees his face.
It's him. It's him.
Are you all right?
Probably meaning that the lights weren't actually off the entire time. That was part of John's hallucination, not being able to see the light. Sherlock just subjected John to a very scary situation, but he instantly reassures him and tells him that nothing he saw was real, that he was drugged.
Are you all right?
John.
Did you see it? You must have.
It's all right.
It's okay now. You saw what you expected to see because I told you. You have been drugged. We have all been drugged.
Drugged?
Can you walk?
Come on, walk.
Come on then. It's time to lay this ghost.
The situation is over within minutes, which again, if Sherlock thinks this is okay, which it's not, might be part of the reason that he thinks it is. In the next scene though, we get hints that Sherlock knows that what he did wasn't okay, at the very least after seeing John be so scared. John and Sherlock go to confront Dr. Stapleton and finally expose the truth.
What's on your mind this time?
Murder, Dr. Stapleton. Refined, cold-blooded murder.
Sherlock uses this as leverage to get access to Dr. Stapleton's microscope and look for drugs in the sugar. But in the meantime, Dr. Stapleton explains to John about Bluebell and the other rabbits, and this is where everything with this symbol all comes together. After checking to see if John is okay.
Are you sure you're okay? You look very peaky.
No, I'm all right.
Dr. Stapleton explains the remarkable thing about the rabbits.
It was the GFP gene from a jellyfish, in case you're interested.
What?
In the rabbits.
Oh, yes.
I call her Victoria, if you really want to know.
I put that on screen because I thought she was saying, I call her Victoria for the longest time. But in fact, it's much better than that. Not only is the big government cover-up at Baskerville a bunch of tiny rabbits that light up like fairies, but the gene they use to make this fairy-like effect is called a Chorea Victoria, which ties this glowing gay truth all the way back to the Victorian era. Now, you might say that's just the name of the jellyfish, but they had to come up with all of this. They chose to feature the fairy rabbits in the script, and they chose to have it explained by a jellyfish gene, and they chose to mention the species name, which is close to Victorian. This is all on purpose. John asks why this was done. Dr. Stapleton says,
why?
Why not?
We don't ask questions like that here. It isn't done.
Mm-hmm. But while they might be open-minded behind closed doors, the rest of the world can't know. So Dr. Stapleton had to get rid of Bluebell. Even though it was necessary, she expresses guilt.
It was a mix-up anyway. My daughter ended up with one of the lab specimens, so poor Bluebell had to go.
Your compassion's overwhelming.
I know. I hate myself sometimes.
This is guilt about hiding the truth, but also, with the similarities between Bluebell's disappearance and the experiment on John, Stapleton is telling us that Sherlock feels bad about what he's just done. That's why he's so disappointed when he can't find the drug. All of that was for nothing.
Jesus! Nothing there! Doesn't make any sense!
He starts hinting to John that he was the one who drugged him out of guilt.
Henry Knight, he saw it too, but you didn't, John. You didn't see it.
And we have eaten and drunk exactly the same thing since we got to Grimpen, apart from one thing. You don't take sugar in your coffee.
I see. So
I took it from Henry's kitchen, his sugar. It's perfectly all right.
Since what's happening to Henry is apparently completely unrelated to anything in Baskerville, Sherlock needs to look for more information internally.
There has to be something buried deep.
Can we not keep doing the going deep thing, please? I'm not strong enough. Sherlock goes into his mind palace, which has become increasingly important throughout the series. And notice he only tells Dr. Stapleton to leave. He doesn't mind John being there. John just follows her out.
Get out.
What?
Get out. I need to go to my mind palace.
In his mind palace, the first thing Sherlock associates with liberty are liberty patterns, which is pretty dang gay. Next up is a luxury department store, Liberty London. That's his second association with the word. Again, gay. Also on the list is the national motto of France. One of the first places to decriminalize homosexuality. The LGBT 50th anniversary was held at Independence Hall, where the Liberty Bell is kept. And finally, the Liberty Bell March was written by John Philip Sousa, who also happened to write a song called Gallant and Gay Will March Away. The other lists are revealing of Sherlock's mental state too. Sherlock's first association with an inn is an inn like the one where he and John are staying. His first association with hounds are ridgebacks, which are red dogs like Redbeard. Also, Sherlock possibly has a crush on Elvis, and the lyrics they played were Sherlock saying to himself, "You ain't nothing."
You ain't nothing.
He eventually stops exploring his own psyche and puts all the pieces together.
Hound.
We cut back to Henry, who isn't doing any better. Like John, he hallucinates that he's in the dark, running from a monster. But in reality, he's in his home and almost shoots Louise. Guess what he's placed in front of? That parallel is about to come to a head too. Frightened at what he almost did, he runs away, taking his gun with him.
Oh my god. Oh my god, oh my god. I am so sorry.
Now, the information about Project Hound is passcode protected, and so they need to get around Major Barrymore's security.
That's as far as my access goes, I'm afraid.
Well, there must be an override, a password.
I imagine so, but that'd be Major Barrymore's.
They're tying conservative people like Barrymore to dangerous experiments which actually hurt people, while open-minded people like Stapleton are making glowing rabbits instead. Sherlock guesses that his password is Margaret Thatcher's first name.
Right, so Thatcher's looking more likely better than Churchill.
So that's the password?
No, with a man like Major Barrymore, any first name terms would do.
And in the commentary, Mark expresses a strong distaste for Thatcher.
That a man like Stapleton would actually put Maggie. Because and it actually came from the fact that Thatcher herself always called Churchill Winston. And I hate that. I hated it.
Again, these associations aren't by coincidence. Along with all the conspiracies in this episode, the really evil thing being done is manipulating people and making them doubt their own perceptions, and ultimately causing them to harm themselves and others.
Project Hound. A new delirium drug, which rendered its users incredibly suggestible. They wanted to use it as an anti-personnel weapon to totally disorientate the enemy using fear and stimulus, but they shut it down and hid it away in 1986.
Because of what it did to the subjects they tested it on.
And what they did to others.
Prolonged exposure drove them insane.
I remember the dark days when that was a fandom motto, and that was totally missing the point of what's going on here. This show is telling us that this kind of literal gaslighting is evil. The true core of the show isn't the hound drug and driving people insane, it's Bluebell and lighting up and revealing the truth. And again, we see that even small word choices can tell you everything.
Someone who was old enough to be there at the time of the experiments in 1986. Maybe somebody who says cell phone because of time spent in America. You remember, John?
Mm-hmm. Here's my cell number.
John gets a call from Louise Mortimer telling him what Henry did.
He's got a gun.
He went for the gun and tried to...
And Sherlock knows there's only one place he'll go. Back to Dewar's Hollow.
Henry?
He's attacked her.
Gone? Mm. There's only one place he'll go, so back to where it all started.
We cut back to Henry in the Hollow as he's preparing to commit suicide. What's pushing him over the edge?
I'm so sorry, Dad.
Not that he just shot someone, but that he was unable to clear his father's name after his death. That the world will always think he was a liar and a fraud. If you know what's coming in the next episode, that should sound familiar. This all is what would have happened to John had Sherlock never come back. With Mary in his ear, he never would have recovered, and he would have eventually reached this desperate point himself. Sherlock and John arrive in time to stop him, though.
Oh, Henry, no! No!
Henry starts talking about what he is. He feels like a monster and a failure.
I know what I am. I know what I tried to do.
Just put the gun down. It's okay.
No, no, I know what I am.
But Sherlock isn't as heartless as he tries to make it seem. He knows how to relate to people, and he knows how to talk Henry down.
Yes, I'm sure you do, Henry. It's all been explained to you, hasn't it? Explained very carefully.
What?
Someone needed to keep you quiet. Needed to keep you as a child to reassert the dream that you both clung onto because you had started to remember. Remember now, Henry, you've got to remember what happened here when you were a little boy.
Again, all of this is happening to Henry because he had to be stopped from finding the truth.
You'd started to piece things together. Remember what really happened here that night. It wasn't an animal, was it, Henry? Not a monster. A man. Then you started to remember, so you had to be stopped. Driven out of your mind so that no one would believe a word that you said.
Sherlock hints in this speech that he knew that the innkeepers didn't really put down the dog.
The hound last night. We did.
Yeah, but it was a dog, Henry. Leaving footprints, scaring witnesses, but it was nothing more than an ordinary dog.
Just as he's almost completely calmed Henry down, the dog shows back up, scaring everyone.
But there never was any monster.
It's starting to look like the monster was real after all, but then Sherlock sees someone lurking in the shadows. Remember, he's currently drugged to see his worst fears given the proper stimulus. So who does he see when he takes off the mask?
No!
If you didn't already believe that Sherlock is terrified of Moriarty, you should now. But it's not actually Moriarty, it's Franklin, the Mary parallel.
Fog.
What? It's the fog! The drug! It's in the fog!
He demands that someone kill the dog, and John does it first try.
For God's sake, kill it! Kill it!
Sherlock drags Henry over to see that the dog really is just a dog.
Look at it, Henry. No. Come on, look at it!
Once he realizes the truth, he turns on Franklin.
It's just your boss.
Faster! Jesse, yes! I'm alive! Make a noose!
Come on!
Why didn't you just... kill me! Because dead men get listened to. He needed to do more than kill you. He had to discredit every word you ever said about your father.
Again, the true evil is staying with someone, pretending to care about them, but really manipulating and gaslighting them. They all hear another howl, and Franklin takes the opportunity to run away.
Franklin!
Only he doesn't get very far. villains on the show who manipulate people under the guise of genuine care and concern will bring about their own downfall. Back at the Cross Keys Inn, Billy brings John his breakfast while Sherlock brings John his coffee. Not done with the gay mirrors yet, I see.
Thanks, Bill.
Sherlock keeps pretending that he doesn't understand sentiment when he really does all too well. But at this point, John is supplying the lies himself.
So they didn't have it put down then, the dog?
Obviously, because they just couldn't bring themselves to do it.
I see.
No, you don't.
No, I don't. Sentiment?
Sentiment. Mm.
John finally figures out that Sherlock tried to drug him.
Hang on. You thought it was in the sugar. You were convinced it was in the sugar.
Better get going, actually. There's a train that leaves in half an hour, so if you want...
Oh, God. It was you. You locked me in that bloody lab.
And we can see when John looks away that Sherlock genuinely does look remorseful, even as he's trying to play it down.
I had to. It was an experiment.
An experiment?
Shh.
I was terrified, Sherlock. I was scared to death.
I thought the drug was in the sugars. I put the sugar in your coffee. Then I arranged everything with Major Barrymore.
It's all totally scientific, laboratory conditions, but literally.
Now, people tend to equate this with Mary lying about her identity the entire time she knew John, and shooting and literally killing Sherlock to protect herself. But aside from the fact that those two things aren't really on the same level, the narrative itself is telling us to treat them differently. John doesn't talk to Mary for months after he finds out the truth. Here, he just points out the fact that Sherlock got it wrong.
But it wasn't in the sugar.
No, well, I wasn't to know you'd already been exposed to the gas.
So you got it wrong?
No.
Mm. You were wrong. It wasn't in the sugar. You got it wrong.
A bit. Won't happen again.
And goes back to joking with him within a minute.
Any long-term effects?
Not at all. You'll be fine once you've excreted it. We all will.
I think I might have taken care of that already.
John isn't that angry about it. The story is presented in a way that lets both characters move on pretty quickly, rather than drawing attention to a long rift. Sherlock looks over at Burly Gay, who happens to be wearing a purple button-up shirt. Just like John is. Things like that aren't coincidences. They happen on purpose. Sherlock gets up and says he's going to see a man about a dog, which is an English euphemism for going to the bathroom. So it ties back into the last joke.
Where are you going?
It'll be a minute. Gotta see a man about a dog.
But I also personally think that Sherlock really did go over there to see a man about a dog and offer to buy the innkeepers a new one, because Sherlock really does like dogs. Things tie up nicely in Dartmoor, but as we know, the greater threat of Moriarty has been looming over this entire series, and we see him at the end of the episode. Mycroft is the one to order Moriarty's release. Suspicious.
All right. Let him go.
And we see Moriarty's true obsession. Not with money or power or fame. He's out to win Sherlock. And if he can't have him, no one will. At least I have a whole month to prepare for the pain of the Reichenbach fall. Until then, the usual acknowledgements. A huge thank you to Marcel Marxism for talking about Bluebell theories with me. It really helped me work out this script, and you should definitely go follow him. Thank you also to the real Toby Hooper for letting me reference your meta on the Stapleton Sherlock parallels. Huge thank you to Werelock Holmes, Baker Street Skull, Erebush, Benedict Sherlock, Guard Goddess, Keep Me Right, Howling Turtle Blog, Mark Gatiss, I know it's not actually him, but I still feel honored, Stars Over Gallifrey, Wing Garden, Ellie Lee, sorry if I said that wrong, Make Your Deduction, Where It Counts, The Celestial Mother, and Captain Liddy. Thank you also to Finn Gian for donating Zer artwork to the campaign, and to everyone else who donated and boosted. I'm sorry if I left you out. Please message me if you want to be thanked publicly in a video. I'm sorry I'm running a bit behind on the dates already. I actually fell like a full week behind on the Molly video, so I'm slowly catching up by a few days, and I hope to get caught up to the schedule that I release soon. So I'll be back pretty soon for a discussion on mirrors in series 1 and 2. Until then, thank you for watching, and get ready to believe. Here she comes. Watch out, boy, he'll tear you up. Oh, here he comes. He's a man eater. You ain't nothing.